Welcome to the next instalment of Informatics 1B's coverage of inheritance. Today we're going to start off by seeing another example, and then we're going to talk quite a bit about polymorphism and about overriding. So just to recall, inheritance allows you to abstract out common stuff from several classes, and so we saw this example before where we have a student class and its two specializations, UG student and PG student, PG student having an additional ability to respond to the message tutor. And we discussed how every class in Java inherits from the class object. We can have, of course, a flat animal hierarchy, meaning that each class inherits only from one other class, that is, each class representing a kind of animals inherits directly from the animal class. That works fine. Notice the way this diagram is showing the make noise method separately in the subclasses, but it's not showing the sleep and the roam methods separately in the subclasses. That indicates that make noise is being overridden or implemented specially in each of these subclasses, but sleep and roam are simply being inherited. So we can have a base class animal written in Java like this, and then we can have a subclass lion, a public class lion extends animal, which overrides the make noise method and makes it do something different. And similarly, cat can have a different version of make noise, as can wolf, as can dog. If we then think about how we use those different classes, we get code like this. So we can end up creating ourselves two different animal objects, one of class wolf and one of class lion. And if we send each of them each of the three different messages that they understand, then you see what happens. The make noise method is invoked from the wolf class or from the lion class respectively, whereas the roam and the sleep methods are invoked directly from animal. That's the only version there is, because the specific animals don't override them. And you get output like this. We could, however, create ourselves a nested hierarchy. We could group together lions and cats as felines, and dogs and wolves as canines, and we could observe that felines and canines have systematically different roam behaviours, and so we could implement roam at the intermediate level in the feline and canine class. And then it would look a bit like this. So now lion, for example, is inheriting sleep from animal, roam from feline, and implementing make noise itself. And the code ends up looking like this. Animal hasn't changed. The new class feline overrides the roam method, as does the new class canine. And lion now extends feline rather than directly extending animal, and that gives us the hierarchy that we saw in the picture. And so on. And then when we create ourselves a new wolf animal and we send it in turn each of the three messages that it understands, in each case it gets the implementation of the method from the most specific class where one exists. So make noise comes from the wolf class itself, roam comes from canine, and sleep still comes from animal. Like that. And you get output like that. Next we're going to talk about polymorphism, which is kind of the point of doing inheritance in object orientation. So what do we mean by polymorphism? So the word means many shapes, and in biology you'll see people saying things like it means that one object can take many shapes, and people try to import that into OO, but that's not really the important meaning in OO. The important meaning of polymorphism in OO is that the same piece of code can be assigned multiple types, as we'll see. I mentioned before that we tend to pun between classes and types in OO. They're not literally the same thing, but a class defines a type, and roughly speaking the type is given by the signature of the methods of the class. We can talk about one type S being a subtype of another type T, And what we mean by that is something like a substitutivity property. We expect to say that if you have any context which is supposed to handle arbitrary values of type T, then because a value of type S is supposed to satisfy this is a relationship, it's supposed to be the case that you can think of an element of type S as an element of type T. Therefore, the context which was expected to handle any values of type T should be able to handle a value of type S, because a value of type S is a value of type T. The subtype relationship is reflexive. Any type is a subtype of itself, and it's transitive. Any subtype of a thing which is a subtype of another thing is a subtype of the other thing. And we use the term supertype and subtype as opposites in that way. Now let's see a bit about how we can use polymorphism in object orientation. So here is a piece of code that doesn't, just to get us started. We've got a go-to-bed method which takes an animal and sends that animal the sleep message. And here we're going to invoke that method by, first of all, creating an animal object and then passing it to the go-to-bed method. So, polymorphism means that the same piece of code can be assigned multiple types. And in our case, that's going to, in particular, be an object reference that could end up having multiple types. So an object passed into a method could come from any one of many classes. Now, in Java, we have what's called object-oriented polymorphism, and what that means is that the classes that could be the type of a thing that's passed into a method will be related by inheritance. You've seen a slightly different kind of polymorphism in Haskell. So, any method that was written to expect an object of class animal will still work if it is given an object of class wolf, because remember the is a relationship. Any object of class wolf is a object of class animal. So this is the thing. Java, the language, will ensure that such code compiles, but the way to ensure that you actually get sensible results when you pass an object of class wolf to a method that's expecting an object of class animal, despite any overriding of methods, redefining of behaviour that the class wolf might have done, is where the is a check comes in. It's the developer's responsibility to make sure that the way that they redefine behaviour is sensible and doesn't cause context to do bizarre things. So here we have exactly the same method again. The go-to-bed method is taking an arbitrary animal, and now we're invoking it, but this time we're passing it a new wolf object. And that should work just fine. And the point is that the result of the sleep message being sent to the animal should be the appropriate implementation of the sleep method in the wolf class. Here's another example of polymorphism. We can have an array list, or any other collection, of course, that is set up to be able to take arbitrary animal objects, and then we can iterate over the animals that are actually in that collection, and we can send them appropriate messages, and we can pass them to appropriate methods. And it's perfectly fine to add objects whose most specific class is actually a subtype of animal. So, for example, we can add an instance of wolf, of lion, of cat, and of dog to our array list of animals, and that's no problem. In other words, array list of animal is polymorphic. And if we send the make noise message to an object that is taken out of this array list of animals, you might wonder, does that message cause the invocation of the make noise from the most specific class of the object, as the object actually turns out to be at runtime, or does it, because this is declared to be an array list of animals, use the make noise implementation from animal? Well, either possibility would be possible, and some languages, like C++, for example, had both. In Java, the answer is we always have dynamic choice of class, and it will always be the most specific class whose implementation is actually used. Back to the student example for a moment. Let's have a think about this. Could we do this? We have a give tutorial method. It takes an arbitrary student, and then we send the tutor message to that student. And we invoke the method like this. We create a new PG student, and we send that student to the give tutorial method. So we've got a student that can in fact tutor, and that's the one we're passing to the give tutorial method. But it doesn't work. It doesn't work because the promise of the signature of the give tutorial method is that it's supposed to work for an arbitrary student, and yet the body of that method will not work for an arbitrary student. It will only work for a student that understands the tutor message. In other words, there's a mismatch between the supposed type of the parameter, which is student, and the required type of the parameter, which is PG student. So the compiler will spot that and complain. Here is one possible way you could attempt to get round it. You could, within the body of the code, you could take our arbitrary student and we could try casting it to PG student. That's what the PG student in brackets is doing there. And then we could send it the tutor message. And that does actually work, but it's going to give you a problem if somebody calls this method with a student that is an undergraduate student. So that's not very good. If you really must cast objects to other types, then you could protect that cast like this. So in other words, you could check before you attempt to do the cast from an arbitrary student to a PG student that it's going to work by using that check support instance of PG student guarding it. However, this is really, really bad style. Casting in Java is a pretty bad smell anyway. And no, just don't do it like this. You know, write methods that actually have a correct match between the arguments they supposedly take and the arguments they actually take. We're going to say a bit about the difference between overriding and overloading, because this is a topic that often confuses people. So let's think a bit more about what you have to do in order to be overriding a method of a superclass. So we've got our animal class again, and just for the sake of argument, we've got a findPlaymate method in it this time, which is supposed to return an object of type animal. How should Wolf be able to override that findPlaymate method? Stop for a moment and think about what you think would make sense. So, here are some conditions that must be obeyed. The parameter lists must be the same. Okay, so one thing that's not okay, it's not overriding, is for the Wolf class to add an argument to the findPlaymate method and think that in doing so it is overriding the findPlaymate method from animal. You have to have the same parameter lists. The return type must be either the same or a subclass of the original. It's worth thinking about why changing the return type to a subclass of the original should be okay. So in this case we're saying it should be fine for the Wolf class to say that in its specific implementation of findPlaymate it's going to always return an object of class Wolf as the result. Well, that should be okay because after all, any object of class Wolf is an object of class Animal, so it still meets the contract, meets the specification laid out in the base class, which is one of the things it should do. And it should be fine in any context, because any context that calls the findPlaymate object on an animal should be expecting to handle an arbitrary animal object as a result. And an element of the Wolf class is an object of the Animal class, and so the context ought to be able to handle that fine. Later on you'll meet a thing called Liskov substitutivity, which goes into a lot more detail about this, but we're not going to say much more about that today. And finally, the overridden method must be at least as accessible as the original. So you can't override a method and simultaneously make it more private than it was to start with. So that's a summary of those things that we said. However, most of the versions that were not overriding that you just saw do in fact compile. It's just that they're not overriding, they are overloading. And this can get really confusing because it will mean that the both versions of the method are around, and which one you get will depend on the specific arguments or whatever, the specific contexts in which they're used. So you've seen in the context of println that you can overload, you can have multiple different versions of the method that take different types of arguments, and you can do that, of course, in your own methods as well. You can have different return types, but you can't only change the return type, you'll find. I think that's kind of for technical reasons. And you can, in fact, change access levels up and down, although it's usually considered bad style to do so because it can be really confusing. Let's look at a few more examples. As usual, have a look at the code. Once you're sure you know what it prints, then resume the recording and go on. This prints roll, roll, and pedal, pedal, because this works just how you might expect. The references C and B are polymorphic. They contain instances of car and bike, respectively, and so when you send them the drive message, the appropriate implementation of the drive method is the one implemented. Now, what about this one? 3.6 and the float version of 6, because we have three overloaded versions of the add method here, and we're invoking them differently. What about this one? This time we are overloading methods by swapping parameter types around. This is a really horrible thing to do. Never ever do this. You will just confuse anybody who's trying to call your methods. But technically speaking, you can. Now, what about this one? That doesn't compile. Remember, changing only the return type when overloading doesn't work. It'll get treated as an incorrect version of overriding. Although, actually, yes, this is hard to interpret as overriding, but anyway, it doesn't work. You can't change just the return type and nothing else. So in summary, in some object-oriented systems, inheritance structures can get long and nested, and they can certainly be as long and nested as they need to be. That's not in itself a good thing. So object-oriented beginners tend to think inheritance is a very snazzy new tool in their toolkit and use it too much. Really keep things simple. Polymorphism is when code can be given several types, and we've seen two main examples of that. You can collect objects of different subtypes in a collection that is defined at the common supertype, so we saw ArrayList of Animal, for example. And you can use the same client code on objects of different subtypes of the type the code is written for, and message sends within the client code will be interpreted at whatever the runtime class of the parameter being passed in is. You get dynamic binding of methods, of messages to methods. Overriding has to follow three rules about having the same parameter list, about having a compatible return type, and about being at least as accessible. If it fails to follow some of those rules, you may accidentally get overloading instead of overriding, and that will cause strange results when you do things like passing objects into methods, so try to avoid that. And in fact, overloading between different classes in a class hierarchy can be really confusing, and on the whole it's best avoided. Overloading within a single class tends to be much easier to get right and much safer and much more often useful. And as before, the reading is specified from objects first. I think you'll find we're still within chapter 5 if you're using the Java tutorial instead, but you'll find this material in whatever book you're using.